Okay, here we are, and it's that third hour on Mondays. You know what that means. It's time to spend an hour with Yoichi Shimatsu, one of the world's most ferociously intelligent investigative research journalists, former editor of the Weekend Japan Times. He's an extraordinary man, an environmentalist. He never ceases to amaze me about the things he understands, his sources, his understanding of the big picture. He's a remarkable fellow, and I think you've come to know him through his writings, certainly his appearances on this program for over 3 years now. And he's standing by, I believe, in Thailand. Are you there, Yoichi?
Yes, I am, and thank you for that introduction. I'm not sure I deserve it. I actually do a lot of stumbling, make a lot of mistakes, have to double check.
That's how that makes you human, my friend, and that's how we all learn.
And and that's what science is about, the process of trial and error.
Absolutely.
You can have a hypothesis, but instead of stand the test of, you know, discoveries, of research, of findings.
Yeah.
And so your original ideas of, you know, that you might suggest as a coding procedure get changed. Usually something a lot more complicated, much more interesting, and the final analysis more elegant. All the pieces fit together. So that's
right.
Sort of the great joy of pursuing science, and unfortunately, really terribly, disgracefully, I believe that most of the world's scientific establishment has fallen away from that just basic, very basic methodologies of science. You know?
Well, I agree.
Science is based on doubt. You doubt yourself. You put out a theory, but you have to have doubt about your own theory. You have to be willing to overturn it. But since the age of Einstein's relativity, everyone seems to be more involved, you know, since then, in creating these major theories, you know, rather than getting out in the field and looking for the hard facts, looking for the facts that will overturn your own theory. This is what it's all about.
Well, it was that way.
In our recent investigation, yeah. Malaysia Airlines, we wish some facts would come out to overturn that, what we suggested, right? Of a hijack.
Absolutely.
Industrial theft. I wish that could be overturned. It would make life a lot easier for the families of the passengers and all that. But despite our fondest wishes for that to happen, we still haven't found the fact, that single fact that overturned that. So this is a problem. The theory still holds until that fact is found.
I wish...
We talk to you... Hmm? Yes.
I wish we could get Sarah Vajic on the program. I'd love to talk to her. She's obviously, as we discussed last time, a very angry woman because she knows a lot, and she's held back admirably.
She came out with another statement yesterday saying that this attempt to issue death certificates for the passengers, there's absolutely no proof that they're dead, you know, and that it's covered. She just came out, I believe, recently. I saw something in an Australian paper about that. She continues to fight. I'd like to find her. But unfortunately, I don't, at this point, have the time or resources to get up to Beijing and, you know, seek her out. If she's still there, she might be back. Who knows where she is now.
Yeah, well, she's
It's true that she has been a very courageous person to break ranks, but she is very much embedded in the whole U.S. commercial, you know, intelligence is the word, but let's say commercial strategy. America has obviously a foreign, you know, a strategy to increase foreign trade, which it has to do, just to balance, for the balance of payments.
Mm-hmm.
And she's one of those people, business executives, active out there, very trying to drum up, you know, business and support for American suppliers and all that. So she's overall, you know, I mean, doing a knockout job, and she came out very honestly for someone who's inside the system to come out that forthrightly. But we don't have a single scientist, really, of major standing, especially in the United States.
No, I haven't seen any.
Willing to break ranks.
Exactly.
Yeah, here's one brave woman who's really ready to go up against everything she's been, you know, educated in or thought into and, you know, worked for, and she's come out to, you know, say the claim mistaken and that her husband-to-be was aborted and treated very badly and by these unknown military personnel, based on his call from Diego Garcia. So
here's
she's very strong. And when we have the whole world at stake, not just a couple hundred passengers on an airliner, we're talking about all of humanity, all of life on Earth at stake. we can't find a single scientist that has half of Sarah Bajak's gut and honesty. We can't find a single one. And you
well
know, right
said.
Now, yeah. our problem is that just this last week, there's been a major offensive by, scientists who've been financed by NOAA, the American Meteorological Agency,
yeah.
By NASA, MIT, Utah University, to very prematurely, based on scant evidence, come out and attack what you've been pointing out about the California, what they call the California drought, the whole West Coast drought that occurred this winter for months. You know, the standing wave in the Pacific Ocean, the diagonal standing wave, the straight line wave in the Pacific Ocean. Now a major cover-up has come up, and you have to wonder, taxpayers have to wonder, if you're going to pay for a lie, why bother hiring expensive scientists? Just get some, you know, low-end sub-editor or some wire service to crank out lies. It's a lot deeper and more effective.
Yeah.
Plus, he knows how to frame a lie more effectively, so it's not... You know, and there's another also paper that you got to understand on the Arctic ozone layer where MIT scientists are saying, oh, it's not such a serious problem. It's not such a big problem. On the other hand, it opened up massively in March 2011. March 2011 is when this ozone hole opened up. It's not a bad ozone hole over the Arctic. This thing that well, it's explainable by CFCs, even though CFCs are now banned. In other words, there's a declining amount of CFCs being produced, being emitted, and yet they're saying the CFCs caused all of a sudden, 2011, March 2011, the ozone hole. So these two studies are very much interrelated as scientific, I say pseudo-scientific denial of the climate impact of the Fukushima radiation releases, those massive plumes of radiation that you saw. You published maps and all that. Fast purple clouds overwhelming the U.S. West Coast, Canada.
Well, when I began this this last winter after you had so eloquently laid out the reasons why the climate was being impacted, something else happened. And what we saw, and for those of you who didn't pay attention, was all the North Pacific weather systems that come roaring out of Kamchatka and Japan, move across the Pacific, slam into the West Coast from Baja all the way up to Canada, move into the Cascades, the Sierras, and then into the Rockies, the Midwest, reform, and then they all came across the Pacific and got about two-thirds of the way across and ran into a brick wall. Now, when I saw that happening, I've been watching the weather since I was a little kid. I started to collect satellite images of the Eastern Pacific to watch what happened to these storms as they came across. And I posted it several times and updated it. And there was no question whatsoever that an enormous high-pressure ridge was blocking, shredding and destroying storm system after storm system after storm system. Now, they're trying, I guess now you told me, to explain this away somehow. It was so obvious and embarrassing. They didn't say anything for a long time. They tried to blame it on El Nino. No way. Doesn't happen. What's the latest on this?
There was no El Nino, right? There was no... Well, this paper that came out, it's in the Geophysical Research Letters Journal. It's been accepted. The lead scientist is Simon Wang out of Utah State University. And he's basically saying that traceable anthropogenic warming footprint, well, that's the title, has caused this enormous intensity of this ridge throughout the winter of 2013-14. And this is associated with the drought and intensity. In other words, he's saying that there's an anthropogenic footprint here. In other words, global warming
absolutely ridiculous.
The tropical Pacific is what caused this ridge, okay, to swell up and form. I mean, this is the first winter that it didn't rain in Seattle. You know, everyone knows you go to Seattle, it's dreary. It rains, okay? It didn't rain in Seattle. Okay? Obviously, global warming had that cause all this heated water to rise from the Pacific. You would have massive floods in Seattle over this winter, correct?
You bet.
Correct?
You bet.
I mean, there is so many inconsistencies. These reports are being hurried out. You know, they're not really being, the peer review process is just a rubber stamp. You know, when they hold on, it's about all the inconsistencies, all the contradictory bits of evidence here. They're just being brushed out. And then all the global warming, you know, the climate scientists are hailing this as the great new paper, although it's a very, very thin little paper, and most of it is speculative, hardly. And it's trying to say that, well, the global warming has moved this grid steadily towards the northeast to block out the low pressure fronts that's carrying all the moisture from the Asia side of the Pacific.
Yeah.
This is patently ridiculous. You know, they just removed, you know, just removed. It doesn't stand still because of a, uplift from the eastern Pacific, from the, you know, California-Mexico side. It doesn't stand still. It just blows that away, okay? It just pushes it right aside. You know, the cooler, denser air pushes away the lighter, warmer air. Am I not correct? The denser pushes away the lighter, you know?
You got
it. This whole theory that the lighter air mass, the warm air, is holding back, like you say, the whole Siberian high from bursting through the jet stream version is patent nonsense. And I hope people read, bother to read this paper and see that it's nothing but apologetic for global warming theory.
Now, you're working on a paper yourself on this, right?
Yeah. Well, it's complicated because I got to defend against these two attacks. You know, these two extremely offensive papers, you know, so which are generating a lot of excitement in the pro-global warming circle. And I told you before, I'm not against the idea of global warming. I just don't think it's so dramatic. It's so sudden. You know, I kept saying before, it's an issue over the next century. It's not an issue in our time immediately. I mean, Fukushima has had a massive impact. And as you suggested here, there may be an element of what's called geoengineering. I think geoengineering is sort of a bad word, but you know, it's basically that the weather systems over the Pacific were manipulated, as they could be, because of the highly radioactive nature of the water particles coming from across from the whole Fukushima.
Well, let's put it this way: after almost 3 years, the amount of the Pacific Ocean that is heavily radioactive now, which creates, feeds, and bolsters these storm systems, was, I think, producing potential rainfall that would have been so embarrassing to NOAA and the EPA and everybody else that they had to make a choice. Do we let these things come in, and everybody with a radioactive detector can go out and start measuring rainwater and downspout water and all that, or do we block them and create a drought? And I think they opted to buy themselves time. I don't know what the hell for, but I think that's what happened. Next year, in a few weeks now, entire Pacific will be radioactive.
Massive amounts of radioactive rain coming down. They would rather it drop into the Pacific, right, rather than over the Sierra Nevada and the whole Central Valley there in the Pacific Coast Range, which would have been disastrous. That would have probably caused a mass evacuation if that occurred. So
it would have been total panic. The real estate market would have crashed. My God, people would have been literally running for their lives in some cases. The public would have been able to handle it.
The end of the healthcare system is everyone goes to the hospital for checkups. It would have been the end of healthcare. Yeah, I mean, the hospitals would have been jammed across. Not just the Western states; they would be fleeing all away from the West.
Across the country.
How do they do this? Is the question? Yeah, I think it's hard to imagine how they did this. I mean, the existence of the HARP system outside of the Fairbanks, what's the name of the city there, Anchorage, Alaska. That's well known by now. That you know they have tried at times successfully to manipulate the weather, and that's right outside of this HARP area, so just a high altitude shot up through the ionosphere and back down. But the other thing is, everyone has been wondering what that mysterious Air Force mini shuttle has been doing up there for 400 days. What has the shuttle been doing up there? Very possibly involved also in very low-intensity laser sweep as it comes down, just to basically warm up that cold front and just sort of dissipate it.
Yeah,
you know, sort of
yeah.
Try to get that cold low front sort of basically back up on itself. It's sort of like throwing a wave back on itself, very possibly. This is very similar to the laser gun experiment that happened in Maydex that led to the crash of the Columbia. You know, they changed the weather over the Middle East, so that was relatively cool when Allied troops invaded Iraq. There was snowfall in Israel right after that. Huge water spouts were generated off Cyprus that swept in where it did a lot of disruption there. People in Cyprus all know that this was done by by this spaceship Columbia. And it changed it basically. So it is possible, using not just one thing, but a series of technology, to hold back a massive front like that. It doesn't take much because in that water is so radioactive. You know, it's highly ionized. In other words, it's carrying electrical charge. You know, so it's very easy to manipulate something like that, something of that low density with an electrical charge. But I think, but what is amazing is that they'll roll out this study so prematurely. It usually takes years for these things to come out, right, to be peer-reviewed, that they rolled it out by what is this now, right? April? Yeah. I mean, March is October, you know, the end of the season is already over. They rolled this thing out so quickly because of what you've been pointing out. So, obviously, you hit them where it hurts. You know, you pinch them where it hurts, and now they're trying to salve the wound and put everyone back to sleep.
That Air Force...
Well done, Jeff. You did a good job exposing this whole thing. But unfortunately, you cost the U.S. taxpayers millions of dollars to try to rebut you. million-dollar lies to rebut you. Yeah?
Well, thank you. I was... It really bothered me looking at those satellite pictures when you see the geometry, for God's sakes, right angles on a high-pressure system. Forget it.
Yeah.
The X-37B space plane, by the way, is nearing 500 days in orbit now up there. 500 days. And one story is asking, will the X-37B space plane ever come down? Well, obviously it will at some point, but it's been up there for a long time. It's the Air Force's robot space plane.
Yeah. Well, this was originally a NASA project that the Air Force took over. So NASA still has sort of a hand. It's just the Air Force budget that I had.
Well, remember, NASA is military. NASA is always military first.
Yeah, that's right. Well, there's a lot of concern about the whole collapse of the weather system above the Northern Hemisphere, which has done massive damage to the American economy. Yeah. Not to mention destroyed hundreds of homes, and, you know, businesses and so on, is wrecking now in North America. So it is obviously an issue. Certainly the Central Intelligence Agency would certainly be very worried about, because their global warming theory isn't panning out. Something completely different, something grotesque is happening here that caught them, you know, knocked them sideways, and they're just trying to react, and they're using global warming as kind of a cover. They're just using that as a... I don't think they believe it anymore, you know, because temperatures haven't been rising that steadily anymore. You know, the UN panel is pretty much discredited right now. There's, you know, even one of the members of the panel, scientists, quit because there's nothing but exaggeration of the negative effects here. So that whole theory is collapsing, so therefore it's only used now as sort of like a curtain to hide the truth here, you know? So basically, let's look at the two competing theories here. One is from the University of Utah and NOAA, which says that this warm weather is coming. They can't even point to an El Nino. They say this coming now, this El Nino to come, as if the El Nino can act from, you know, on some spiritual level from the deep bottom of the ocean. Now, this is insane. There's either El Nino or there's not. There's not an approaching possible, El Nino, the spirit of El Nino to come. It's not a zeitgeist. I mean, this is ridiculous, okay? This is so unscientific claptrap, okay? That's causing the big bend in the jet stream. Now, if you look at the map in this report, which I'll include in my article, you will see that this warm area of high pressure, warm, very warm temperature high, runs from Southern California up the Pacific coast across to Western Canada and across Canada over Greenland. And this, these are exactly the areas that were massively clobbered in third week in late March of 2011 by the Fukushima releases, which just stunned everybody at how swift they came across the Pacific and how forceful, I mean, what high levels of radiation they dropped all over that area. So very coincidentally, we see not a jet stream of a normal sine curve. We see a jet stream that's been broken, okay, across Canada, okay? Across Canada, the jet stream has been broken, okay? It's been sort of breached by this whole Fukushima plume that came across. And the whole point is that that is when this Arctic ozone hole, when scientists in Norway and Japan, they lifted off these balloons, they found a noticeable decline in the ozone hole, in the ozone layer over the Arctic, okay? So the radioactive compound, no doubt, scientifically, these isotopes do destroy ozone. They're ozone destroying. Therefore, we see, and there's a paper written before that, a few months in January by the Alfred Wegener Institute in Potsdam, okay, which says that the Arctic, the gradual warming of the Arctic, I mean, no one's denying the fact that the Arctic Circle has been gradually warming up. But certainly nobody suggested all the Arctic ice would break apart in March and April 2011, that the ice sheet over Greenland will melt away at that same time, that, you know, there'd be this catastrophic change in the Arctic. And so they said, well, the minor changes in the Arctic ice sheet do have this effect on the entire jet stream, on all the, they call it the barometric pressure differences across the whole northern hemisphere, okay, all the air currents across the Earth. This is written before Fukushima. And certainly since then, this massive catastrophic change since March, Fukushima went up, there has been catastrophic change in the weather system, and this is most notable over North America, especially the United States, right, where you see this vortex, Arctic vortex forming, and we've seen all these wild weather effects in the United States. Just unprecedented rampaging destruction, weather systems,
indeed,
tornadoes,
all right,
storms.
Okay. Hold on, Yoichi, just for a couple minutes. We have to take a break. We'll be right back. Yoichi Shimatsu, and our conversation continues. Meanwhile, a top nuclear official is admitting now that the ground, which we've been telling you for over 2 years now, the ground beneath Fukushima reactor buildings is sinking, just like we've told you. Same old, same old. You hear it here first. We'll be right back. Okay, and back with all of you good folks. This funny thing about the ground sinking there, it's already so soggy now. They say you can stick a shovel in many areas and turn one shovel full over and you'll see groundwater. This, of course, is because of the underground aquifer being impeded on its way to the ocean. It's backed up. And the big plan was to start in June to build the ice wall, which would have blocked the entire outflow, or of course it would have gone around it eventually, and what would have happened to that water? It would have rebounded right back into Fukushima Daiichi, and those buildings would have probably started to sink like the setting sun. It would have been a disaster. So now the Japan NRA is having second thoughts, and they're saying they're very concerned about the risk of the groundwater backing up and everything sinking. Well, welcome to the real world, folks. It's about time. Go ahead, Yoichi.
Yeah, this ice wall was just a really bad idea. Yeah, I mean, you know, as you know, anyone who's gone skating, skating on a pond in winter, a natural pond, there's you can see water underneath your feet there, you know, underneath your skate. It's not the ice wall would have stopped the water or frozen the entire plant area stopped, there would still be massive amounts of water flowing in and around the thing. And
sure,
Looking through underneath. Basically, it would just drive down the water further deeper to find new channels, and the water would flow it'll be a multi-billion dollar waste of money, and then it'll be even more difficult to blow the new channels way down below, you know, that open up the new tunnels that the water opens up. Water looks for an escape outlet.
That's well, water is a heavyweight champion. Water will not be denied. It will go under, around, or over.
Exactly. I just fixed the bottom of my bathroom sink. And I put, you know, all kinds of sealants and all that. And when I turned it on, guess what? It starts dripping, okay? That's water for you. You know, it just, no matter what you do, it finds a way somehow. You know?
Right.
So, you know, it's the most insidious stuff to penetrate. And so, therefore, the idea just basically fundamentally was, and it's not really clear why you would build an ice wall, because it wouldn't contain anything. You know, water would just flow out in another direction. It'd back it up, as you said, and make the situation far worse, the whole area more radioactive. It's certainly no solution. The solution is to find a way to remove the radioactive fuel out of the reactors and the spent fuel pools. That's the solution that they feel. You know, the ice wall is just a diversion. It had been a $1 billion diversion and a waste of time from the main job at hand, is how you get the fuel out of melted down reactor cores and out of the ground. Yeah, I mean, yeah, a lot of there's nothing inside the reactor. Some of these reactors, like reactor 3, apparently, and reactor 2, seems everything just gets out. So how do you remove that fuel is the question, or contain that fuel in chemically contain it somehow. That is the question. Basically, put a radiation shield around that thing. Concrete won't do, the radiation crack right through, so it'll take a more sophisticated type of technology to do the bonding. I'd suggested borax all along. Borax crystallized, wonderful stuff, you know, amazing.
Sure.
Stuff. That would do the job. But they, you know, they're not going to attempt something out of the box. They're going to look for engineering solutions rather than science solutions. So I think that's really at the fundamental problem of the outlook of these people. That, you know, there used to be a thing called scientists. But right now, everyone is into technology. Now, how to do something rather than what is that something? What is its nature? Yeah. How do we understand how it works? How do we get it to work in a way that it wants to, in a way that benefits us? That's science, right? Science is understanding the processes behind things, behind the in the chemical elements, in the atomic structure of things. Where technology is just the application, the use of it. I'm afraid this whole process has been just engineered into a total mess right now. Everything they've tried has not just failed, it's made the situation a lot worse. And an example of a gigantic boondoggle of design that some company cooked up and made probably a lot of money from, you know, in subcontracts. And then it's not going to happen. It's been a total waste of time and energy. And again, you know, June is too late anyway, because June is when the rainy season begins. You're not going to be able to freeze anything, because that's very warm, hot water coming off the mountain. And it's radioactive, so it's going to be superheated water coming off the Abitibi Mountain. So, you know, even your construction schedule makes no sense. You know, if you're going to do an ice wall, you do it in the middle of winter. You don't do it at the start of the summer rainy season. So, just these people are out of touch with basic concepts, out of touch with nature. You know, this is what got them there. They just lost track of the natural world. It's been pretty good to humanity overall, you know, over the past millennia. They just completely divorced from that. Live in a little box, you know, inside their little drawings. Very bad situation.
We keep getting
Fukushima, by all accounts, you know, radiation levels are up, by all accounts.
Up. Everywhere, all accounts. The graph keeps going up. Every graph you look at, you're right. Now, the other thing is that what we have are report after report of people who are getting, well, mostly workers from the plant, who say that TEPCO is clueless, the situation is worsening every day, they're afraid for their own safety. Well, obviously, most of them are doomed, but they don't. They say TEPCO doesn't have a plan. They don't have a clue, and things are getting worse and worse and worse. And then I had another story today about young children in cities in Fukushima Prefecture. Young children now who are dying of heart attacks, or what we'd call heart attacks, heart episode, heart failure, all kinds of things clearly related to the radioactivity, that the government is forcing these people to move back home. They have been lying since day one, and they're not going to quit lying about the exposure rates. It's genocide is what it is, and I just can't believe these people are... They grumble, but they go back.
Yeah, this is sad, and then they're surprised when one of their family members dies like that. And I told you, I did talk with that cardiologist long ago, a couple of years ago, who said that the heart is extremely vulnerable to cesium in their diet. And especially their heart size is a whole issue. If you have a smaller heart than a lot of children would have, much more probability you're going to suffer heart failure. And it's very unusual for children to suffer heart failure.
Very unusual.
But when you say I'm exercising outdoors, like immediately after, as I did, as I told you, outdoors, on mandatory school exercises outdoors, they were doing. The Ministry of Education has done a lot of bad things, but that is like criminal.
Well, they're killing their children. Hold on a minute. We'll come right back with Yoichi.
Okay.
Things are just getting worse and worse over there, as we told you they would. All right, we'll be back. Okay, and we're back. If you look at the top of the center column, you'll see the third story down under the latest Fukushima updates. Radiation killing Japan's children. Terrible things are going on. This is a former official saying this. Let me read just a little bit of this to you. The former mayor of, how do you pronounce Futaba? Futaba?
Futaba.
Futaba in Fukushima Prefecture. The former mayor now of this city. He said there, he said a number of things. He said there are still about 2 million people living in the prefecture. We have all sorts of medical issues. This is a former mayor talking. He said, the authorities claim this has nothing to do with the radiation fallout from Fukushima Daiichi. I demanded, said the former mayor, that the authorities substantiate their claim in writing, but they ignored my request. There are some terrible things going on in Fukushima Prefecture. The biggest problem is that there is no one to help us. What he's saying here is that the government has abandoned them to die. I talked to local authorities in different places in Fukushima, but no one would listen to me. They believe what the government says, while in reality, radiation is still there, and it is killing children. They are dying of heart conditions, asthma, leukemia, thyroid complications. Lots of kids are extremely exhausted after school. Others are simply unable to attend physical education classes. But the authorities are still hiding the truth from us, and I don't know why. Don't they have any children of their own? It hurts so much to know they cannot do anything to protect our children. So said the former mayor of Futaba. Just sickening. Sickening what that Abe government has done.
Well, the authorities do have children, but their children are living in places like Shanghai, Bangkok, Los Angeles, Paris.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, they took their children out. Whereas they leave those who, the rest of the country there, basically become a dead gene pool. The children who are not dying immediately, I don't think they'll ever be able to have children without, fast mutation, destroyed chromosomes and embryos. As we've heard from doctors who, from patients of doctors who treated young women in Hong Kong who were there just for less than a week who suffered miscarriages, monstrous abortions, of aborted embryos.
Now,
we're talking about total destruction. If these kids actually do survive, they're not going to be able to have children. They're mutated by now. They're gone.
That's right.
So,
no, I agree.
It's too late to save them. Yeah,
we're not hearing anything about...
The government knows that.
We're not hearing anything about mutations.
Well, the problem is...
Nothing.
Yeah. Well, the problem is, if doctors in Japan do reveal any kind of sensitive information like that, they basically get ostracized by the medical community. Now, and that's by... I've been able to talk to just one cardiologist off the record, okay? And, you know, he's whispering in me and just totally off the record, you know? Situation is bad. This is a couple of years ago. Now, doctors still haven't broken ranks there. I mean, there's a lot of nurses and doctors who have left Fukushima. They've just given up. They just realized it's pointless. Okay, so the number of medical personnel in the province is declining. These people are just abandoned. Well, the situation is far worse than Chernobyl ever was. Chernobyl was evacuated. I mean,
oh, there's no comparison. You know, another thing,
no
Yoichi.
Yeah, we have no idea.
No. Well, you know what else we have no idea about? We don't know how much, on a percentage basis, of the sea life in the North Pacific is now dead. We do know that the sardine fleets from Alaska all the way to Mexico didn't catch one fish. They used to net them up by the countless tons. They're gone. We don't know how dead the Pacific is. We have the yachtsman who sailed from Osaka to San Francisco over 4,000 miles.
Yeah.
He saw exactly two fish, one bird, and one whale with a tumor on its head. That's it. That's all he saw. The North Pacific could be dead.
This cannot be a virus because, you know, like, again, I talked to California fish and wildlife officer and said, there's plenty of fish down by, you know, down by Mexico. There's no shortage of. In other words, it's across the North Pacific. It's down to San Francisco. It's creeping down the California coast. That's where the kill offs are coming from. In other words, if it had been a virus, you know, it would have been the warmer water fish that have been totally wiped out. But no, there's still plenty of fish down there because the radiation levels are still relatively low down there. But it was, again, the California current is working its way south. It's insinuating itself into the warmer water. So we would expect kill off down the road there. And I think all the animal rescue centers are quite aware of the impact on marine mammals. Record numbers of death and both adults and pups. Less effective because they don't go out so far in the current. You know, they stay in the close to the inshore waters. But the adults certainly are just getting clobbered. And they are taking, finally, radiation measurements, but no one's released them yet. I think the understanding is just keep this under observation for now. So a lot of people are watching, and there's alarm out there. But because no one knows what to do about radiation, you know, people aren't, you know, running out of their doors screaming their heads off, you know, which maybe they feel like doing, but can't do because they're just trying to figure out, we can't figure out what to do here. We can't figure out what to do. Terrible situation. And there's got to be better monitoring, obviously, especially among populations who eat a lot of fish. So the problem is not the fish who died off, the kill off. The problem is the fish that are still living, highly contaminated, they're being eaten by marine mammals, by animals like the polar bears, grizzly bears who depend on the seafood for their protein. That's going to work its way in food chain, not to mention the human population. They eat a lot of fish along the West Coast, too. You know, this is a real concern. It's not so much the kill off, it's the fact that it's working its way up the food chain, killing everything. You know?
Absolutely,
it's killing everything.
We just, like I say,
that's a concern, killing things on land. Huh?
We don't know how dead the Pacific is. No one's given me any data. I have seen nothing. I mean, that it could be catastrophic already. We don't know. No one's saying anything.
Obviously, the federal government, the agencies, NOAA.
Oh, they know.
Are paying huge amounts of money. I mean, billions, perhaps hundreds of billions of dollars for this cover-up. You know, the American government money, which could be better used in public education, in terms of even to radiation in your environment, in your diet. Use a simple booklet like that costs only a few million dollars to distribute to every family along the West Coast. But rather, they'd rather spend billions to hide the truth from everybody, the immediate and present danger to their families, to their pets even, not to everything, along the whole, to everything around them, every living species around them. Massive threat. The government is doing quite the opposite. And this is really shameful. And we got to question President Obama's connection to General Electric. We got to question the Department of Energy. I mean, this is a fundamental question that has to be asked about who really controls the American government? Is this a, you know, a government for its people or against its people? Right now, it's acting against its people in the best British redcoat tradition of trying to exterminate Americans, you know, rather than trying to save their lives and protect their security. And this is really, I don't know, it's shameful that this is happening. And, you know, there's this whole theory, these millions of dollars on these rushed out reports to reassure us everything's okay. This is caused by CFC, you know, the Arctic ozone layer is gone because of CFC. But on the other hand, the whole situation in Antarctica is better because there's no more CFC. I mean, this double speak is so blatantly obvious.
Yeah.
And these are, we're talking about MIT, okay? Atmospheric studies at MIT just rushed out a paper on this. And they're stumbling on their own words. They're saying, you know, speaking out both sides of their mouth. Incredible. And, you know, MIT, I think, you know, given all the problems that have happened there, including the that related death of a young hacker there, you know, who was involved there in hacking the place for some obvious reasons that have just complete unethical things going on at MIT, that the American scientific establishment has just completely spreaded itself. You know, I mean, the Europeans do also believe in this global warming theory, but it's more gradualist and so on. And can I tell you just a little aside here on Alfred Wegener, this institute that came out with that report. Do you know anything about him, Alfred Wegener? The polar explorer?
No.
He died in Greenland, yeah. And, yeah, he was the one who, he was the inventor of tectonic theory, basically the continental drift. Okay, you know, he was the first person, he's German.
Okay, I remember the name now. All right, got it.
Wegener, yeah. Now, his daughter, Lottie Wegener, she married Heinrich Harr, you know, the 7 years in Tibet, the first young lad to climb the Eiger, you know, the north face of the Eiger, poster boy for the Nazi party and all that. Wegener, you know, in science, there's always an occult dimension. Many, many scientists, like Newton, were occultists. Wegener also, he believes in ultima thule, this underground civilization within the planet's core. And that's one of the reasons he went to Greenland to search for the entrance to ultima thule. Never came back. So when I flew over Greenland, I had to have a toast to this crazy, chill physicist. You know, amazing story. Great explorer.
That really is, yeah. Now, Yoichi, when the so-called plume, i.e. the entire North Pacific, the radiation, when it hits the Pacific coast, which can be weeks away now, they don't know, it's getting here. Are you going to come back and do more research up and down the West Coast? You planning on that?
I'm planning to, because we've got to make a much more concerted effort, hope to get out a booklet for residents, at least online.
Yeah,
because you
know, without that kind of an effort.
It's time to take this phase more seriously. There's not much we can do for Japan, you know? Not much can be left. The situation is so badly manipulated, mismanaged, that those poor people are just the walking dead, essentially. So you got to save the living at this point, those who have a chance.
Well, that's my idea. My hope is that maybe you can come over. We can work something up, put it online, a booklet for everyone online, guidelines.
Yeah, the
things
Pacific Northwest is definitely is going to bear the brunt. So, you know, in your area. So we'll have to deal with that because it's incoming. It's incoming, unless we just have to hope the American people don't go the way of the Japanese dying off. Like, this is, you know, like gas cheap.
Well, there's going to be some inertia to keep things as they are. The real estate people are going to want to say everything's just fine. You know the game, the tourism, the resorts, all that. So anyway, I'll be here to help if you come over. We're going to do it. We're going to work on it. David,
my guy
in the Bay Area, we're putting up stations. And okay, all right, talk to you next week. Thanks much.
All right, very good.
Okay. Yoichi Shimatsu, and that's our program. Tonight, Monday, off to a roaring start, and we'll be back with you in 21 hours, and we'll keep it up tomorrow night. Hope you have a good day. Take care.
Oh, yeah. Go on. Click the subscribe button.
We need to get subscribed and get this unity stronger. and beat YouTube at their own game. Okay, that's what this is about. Like I say, go to the remix button, hit the remix button. That way you'll have this video and keep up with this. Otherwise, you know, YouTube's just going to control us, guys, and it's really bad.